Welcome. Yeah, privacy by design. As I said, we have to do it in English anyway, because there could be people at the stream who are not understanding English, and it's announced in English. Please, if you have questions, won't understand it, I am able to speak German, and also just ask, and I could translate it. So let's start. Privacy by design. We have some rules for the beginning. I can't do individual consulting here in the talk. I had some problems years ago with my slides, where I got lots of trouble. My slides are not have any, no standalone meaning. So only any, you have to hear what I say, otherwise it doesn't matter what's on the slides, it has no meaning at all. Yeah, and the copyright. So, where am I? My name is Susanne Holzgräfe. My nick is Mirosi. I am a computer scientist. Most of you might know me from databases. I developed Postgres and I developed MySQL and MariaDB and so on. And I worked as a consultant, and I had 40 long-distance flights a year, and I said, okay, you have to do something else. It's too much traveling. And so I made a second job and said, I will go into this GDPR and working as GDPR consultant, so I have more customers close to my home and not always in other countries and other continents. So that's me. I'm doing it since 2012, just for me. I'm reachable, so have lots of contact. I am on Chaos Social, Mastodon. I am on Facebook. Yes, I'm using Facebook. I am on Twitter. I have lots of blogs. My private blog, you will mostly have cooking recipes, something how to make Lapskaus. I'm from Northern Germany, born in Northern Germany. Yeah, I have two companies. I have two companies because that's a tax reason. Because when I'm a data privacy consultant in Germany, you have other taxes as when you are freelance. So that's why I have two companies. Yeah. The first question always is, what's the difference between privacy by design and privacy by default? Is anybody here who knows it? You know it? No. It's very simple. So both are given in the law, privacy by design and privacy by default. Privacy by default is that the software will have, that you are able in the software make settings that provide privacy. It must not, the software must not shipped with the settings, but you should be able to set it. That's why at the moment in the European Union, Microsoft Outlook, Microsoft Internet Explorer, Google Chrome, and I think Windows 10 was it, is not allowed because they have no possibility to make settings that provide privacy, or that provide privacy by default for the user. Privacy by design is that the software is designed privacy friendly. So that's the difference. We are talking here about privacy design. By design, that means when you design your software, you should think about some privacy stuff so that your software is privacy friendly and that you have no problems with it. So, I just explained why privacy by design, because it's given in the laws, it's given in the GDPR, it's given in the e-privacy regulation from the European Union, and that's something the e-privacy regulation always is discussed, but it's not discussed on privacy by design and privacy by default. That's something all countries say that is something that is a must. So privacy by design is not in discussion anyway. So you have to do privacy by design. You should use software that has privacy by design And you should not use anymore any other software what's not designed privacy friendly. So, yeah, what does it mean? That means you should, when you are a developer, you should think about privacy. And how to design my software privacy friendly. Who is responsible? At the moment, responsible are the companies who are using your software. But in future, there are politicians in the European Union and also in Germany who say it can't be. The producers should be responsible too. So in future, it could be that when you have a software product, you will be responsible if it's not designed privacy friendly. It's very important that the vendor is responsible too, should be responsible too. Especially in Germany, they want that the vendor is, they want to make be again, that Microsoft and so on also be responsible for their software and its privacy, and not just the users who are using it or the companies who are using Microsoft or Facebook or whatever else they want, that they are also in duty to be responsible. So, yeah. Personal data. So we are always talking about personal data. Which data are personal? Do you have any ideas? Yeah?
First name, address,
yes.
Every data that's identity.
Yeah, every data that's identity. So it doesn't matter if it's your name. When I say in this group here, yes, let me look. The man with the hat. We have a single man with a hat and everybody knows who it is. Sorry, yeah, so I identified you. So you are very identified. So it's a personal data because we could identify you. When I say the man with the black t-shirt, then nobody knows who I mean because it's more than a group of five. It depends on justice if it's a group of three or a group of five, but when all information you have match to a group of three or five persons, not less than three or five persons, then it's anonymous. Otherwise, when you have a single person, when you have all information, so we have here, we not just have the man with the hat, we have HS4 as room, we have Foursquare, we have the date of today, and whatever else, and so lots of people can identify you. That's personal data, and this it's always a natural person, not a company, a natural person, a real person, and it should not be dead. So privacy always just is on living people, not on dead people, not dead persons. So it's very important too. We have some topics where they discuss if it also will rule for dead persons. It's in the genealogy and how is it? So when you have illnesses that the family could get to and so on. That's for that purpose. But usually it's for living persons as they have to live. They have to be a real person and not a company. That's when you have a doctor or you have a lawyer, you often see that people are allowed to, that people will wait. The lawyer is good, the doctor is bad, and so on. This is allowed because you don't make it for the person, you make it for the company. Because that's the lawyer is a freelancer, is a company. And the doctor is the doctor company and not the person itself. That's the trick how it's allowed. Also, a doctor, of course, has personal rights or privacy, but not when he works, when he reacts as company. It's a little bit tricky on say on freelancers. Yes? No, it's not.
I was expecting it to be an EU-wide law.
It's EU-wide, yes.
So, even if you're a doctor, even if you're a freelancer, then your personally identified data would be considered personal.
No, not all. Yeah, the people are allowed to value, to make rates on you on the internet, to say this doctor is good, this doctor is bad. This is allowed, and in this fact, it's. Not the doctor, not the person. The doctor as a person is the doctor as a company. It's not Germany-specific, that's really EU-specific, because a doctor or a lawyer always is both. Or every freelancer is both. It's a company and it's a private person. And so you have to decide. And the European law, the European judge, said for doctors and lawyers that this rating doctors and lawyers, it's the company and not the person. There is, there was a judge, a European judge. Oh, what's? I don't know the word. Court, European court. Thanks. So, the European court who said that's not so. On freelancers, you always have to look when it's a private person and when it's not a private person. That's a little bit tricky. But for your design and the software, it doesn't matter. There are some rules in the GDPR, you need, or why GDPR? GDPR says all what you make, it should be lawfulness, fairness and transparency. What does it mean? It's, are you allowed to collect this information? It means, is there a law that you are allowed to collect this information? If there isn't a law, then you have to look if you need it, if you really need it, that's the next point. Then when you collect this data, is it fair to the data subject? You have to look into it. And then, this is the third one is, did you make it transparent for the data subject? Did you tell them why you did it, how long you will store it, what you will do with it, and so on? What rights it the data subjects have, and so on. So, did you make it transparent to the data subject? The other is purpose limitation. So you are allowed only to collect data you really need for whatever you want to do, for the purpose. You should only, data you are collecting for one purpose, you should not use for another purpose. There's also, the European Court also decided that when I buy something, then, and I give them my address for delivery, then, of course, it's a good purpose for when I buy it and I want that they want to deliver it, they need my address. It's pretty logical. They are allowed to use it. It's very easy because of the contract. But it's not allowed, and it's not given by the contract anymore that the company will use your delivery address for making any other marketing to you, sending you flyers or whatever else. So that the European Court said that's not a legal purpose for when you just have this I buy from you stuff. There was a question? Not? Okay. Do I have a legal reason? So that's another, it could be that there's a law for which I need your data. For example, in Germany, you need the birth date on hiring because there's a law that you should collect it, or the illness insurance or whatever else. So there are laws. So you can always say, here, there's a law, I need it. I'm allowed to collect. It's another purpose for what you needed. And what you should look when you have, when you collect data, are they really mandatory?
We have it in Germany. Lots of people collect data for invoices. But the invoice law said, private persons don't have a right to get personally invoices. So this is not a legal reason. So you have to look, do I really need this data, or can I do it otherwise? What if I don't have this data? Can I work if I don't have this data? So that's a question you do have to ask yourself when you think about creating a software. Do I really need this piece of data from the person? Do I really need the birthday? Do I really need the address? Do I really need the hair color or whatever else? Or for what do I need it? So, yeah?
Since you mentioned about the employer and date of birth, I realized also that often the picture is required in a CV. I don't know if that is also required by law or is this a norm?
CVs, I don't know other European laws than in Germany. In Germany, there is no law what you place in your CV. It's, the company wants from you a picture, maybe, because, but it's not given any way what you have to place in your CV. There is no law for it. So if you don't do it, but you risk that you won't get the job. It's the same, the companies aren't allowed to get all your reputations, or in Germany you have the right to get how the employee was very good from the old employee, and the new employees, they want to see it. And of course you don't need to send it to them because it's yours, so there's no reason why they need it, but they often want it. So yeah, but there's no law in Germany for this. I don't know how it is in other countries. I'm sure there's no law in Great Britain too, because there were lots of how to write a CV informations, and they are very different. So we have another stuff is data minimization. So you have as less data as possible. So, and then you have to think, are the data you are collecting and you are storing, are they adequate? Are they relevant? Do I really need it? And, yeah, is it limited to what is necessary in relation to the purpose? That's something you always need to think about when you create your software. Then we have the accuracy. Oh, that's very funny. Is it accurate? Is it up to date? You have always to make sure that the data you are storing are up to date. If they are not up to date, if they are invalid, then you should correct them or delete them. But you should be make sure that the data are accurate and up to date. And you have to find a process how to ensure that they are accurate. The other is a storage limitation or the deletion duty. So data you don't need anymore, you should delete, you have to delete. So if you delivered the parcel and the bill, the invoice is paid and all the process is fully done, so you have to wait until the money, you have the money and nobody can claim in front of court anymore, then you should delete the delivery address. If you don't have an okay from consent from the data subject that it's okay to store it further on, but you should, you have to delete it. So you have a delete duty. As soon as the purpose is fulfilled, you have to delete the personal data from the data subject. As long as there isn't a law, that a national or European law, that you have to archive the data. When you have an archiving law, of course, you have to archive them, but then you usually you should pseudonymize them too when you are on archiving. So that's the next anonymization. Pseudonymization, when your purpose is fulfilled and you want your data, when you have to send your data, patients' data, for example, to universities for research, then you should anonymize them. Anonymize, I said, a group of five, minimum of three or five people. The other is when you archive them, because you have a law that you should archive the data, you should pseudonymize the data. That means, I have another slide, what's pseudonymization? So that means you have a key, you should encrypt the data, the personal data, with a key. And so if you need them again, so that you encrypt them. But you should not archive data un-pseudonymized. Yeah?
What does delete mean?
Delete.
Delete can be many things. For example, currently there is Apache Kafka. Software solution that is very popular currently, and it is storing the data there, and there is no possibility just to delete it.
Then you are not allowed to use the software anymore. That's because that's privacy on default. Then this software should be on the list of you should not use it anymore from the European Union, because you have no privacy by default. Because that's the delete. It's the same with some CMS. It's made for your US law, and you are not allowed to delete. And that's all the software is not allowed. You should not use anymore. Random data is anonymized. That's also. Yeah. When you really anonymize them, when you can't get it back, then yes. But delete means really delete. And also the data officers in Germany today, they aren't lawyers anymore. They are computer scientists. They are able to code SQL. And they say, okay, when you need a join, SQL join, you have to delete all of it, cascaded. So not just, okay, I can't see it anymore, but there are always artifacts in my database. No, you have to make sure that all personal data are gone in the database, or even anonymized when you make it, it's of course. Yeah, and as I said, it's privacy by design. It's for designers here. Yeah, and we are talking here about coding your software privacy by design. So yeah, so you have to look for that. You have this storage limitation duty, yes, this deletion duty. You should lock the data that's given to. That's when you. When the purpose is fulfilled, it's a usual use case, when the purpose is fulfilled, but there is a claim in front of court or so, and you need the data. So you should lock them that not every employee and every whatever else, so that not 100 persons can see this data anymore, just the three or five persons, you will see it. So it's a little bit, so usually you have to delete, and I always say, delete it when all this court stuff and so on is gone, or done, then you have to delete. Otherwise, purpose isn't fulfilled. When you are in front of court with your customer, then the purpose isn't fulfilled. Yeah.
Yeah.
As long as returned and no And all this this right to claim in front of court is over. So of course you need, and when you need it for court, of course you have to store it further on. It's then the purpose isn't fulfilled because there's already there's still this claim in front of court. Then the purpose isn't fulfilled. So. Oh no, it's the same purpose. When I order something from you and you deliver it and I say, no, I didn't deliver it or whatever else, so we have a fight and it's in front of court, then it's still the same purpose. For you, it's still the same purpose because I bought it from you or whatever else. So it's a whole process. The purpose of this have to be fulfilled at the end. And of course, you need it. You need it to make sure that... So the next, the five, is integrity and confidential. Of course, you may have to make sure that the data are confidential, that you treat the data confidential, and make sure of integrity. You should look, is it secure? How secure it is? Most of you have IT knowledge. Yeah, I have some customers. Then I ask, how do you take care of security of your server, maybe your web server? They are looking to me and say, what's a web server? Because they are it's companies who not have administrators or so because they are very small. So is it secure? It's a good question. Can it get accidentally lost or destructively damaged, something you need to think about. And then how will you measure it? How will you measure that it could be accidentally get lost? Or how will you measure that it get lost or not get lost? How will you get aware of it that it get lost? It's also, yeah, aware of it.
A question about the data loss. And I think that if my data has been lost or been breached, spread across internet, am I entitled to claim some part of money, some money from the companies? Or because it was my data, like people like me who lost their data and at the like it's I don't know. If
so
I get injury because of some car accident because the car was car manufacturer has.
So when somebody is misusing your data, you should claim in front of the data officers, commissioners. Then it's country depending. In Germany, you won't get money. The state will get money because there will be really high penalties. So it could be that the company who misused your data we get 1 million, 2 million, or whatever else, or even higher penalties, but nothing what you get. So, but you, of course, you can claim for a civil court and then try it. But officially, but it's more if when you make your software, you have to look how will I make sure that it won't get lost accidentally? It's not so easy. Often. Yeah, I already had this case that former administration employees took the data or whatever. So, but on your software, that's not the problem. You just have to make sure that they are safe in your software. Then you have the accountability, how to prove this other compliance before, how to prove without violation privacy. That's a very, very... important. How to prove without violating privacy? I often see companies who look that they make privacy for all the customer data. A lot. But they violate their employee data. A lot. So you always have to think about employees have rights and You are not allowed to install cameras in front of toilets to look when the employee is going to the toilet. You are not allowed to control when the employee is entering the room and when not. Not a single employee. I will have slides for it. So you have to make sure that when you make when you prove this compliance and that you won't violate your employee privacies. It happens very often in the companies. And then you have to look how to demonstrate the compliance the other before. Yes. It's given in the security law that privacy is higher, and it's given in the GDPR. The GDPR is directly under the European human rights. So it's very high. Yeah, and for stolen stuff, they're usually the courts saying, when you have cameras, you can have cameras when there is a body hurt or so, when it's a risk for your life or for others' life. And then it's healthy life, then cameras usually. That's the reason why you are allowed to install cameras. For example, at bank account at banks where they give out money, that they discuss with a risk of life. And then you get an allowance to install the camera, because then they say, okay, the risk of life of this employee is more important than the privacy of this employee. But the boss still isn't allowed to control this employee by this camera. There are some of these, but usually it's when it's your life, or when there's life risk. Not when there's just the monetary risk, like or some material lost, but life lost is a value, a reason where you really say, okay, then the control is okay, but not on things.
The rules for video surveillance at work are different between open surveillance and covered surveillance. So it means, e.g., the bank clerk can be surveilled by video with his permission, but you cannot surveil bank clerks with a hidden video camera.
No.
That's not legitimate.
No, you can't get any legal permission from an employee. That's another reason. You can't get a legal reason. You always can say, okay, the data subject needs to say it's okay. But the data subject needs to have the free will for do it. And the free will never is given when the person is employed. The employer can't get an okay from his employees because they have because of their relationship. So it always, it's not a free will. The court says it's not a free will for an employee. So you can't get an okay from employees as long as they are employed. You only will get it when you have a community, then of course from the members it's okay, but not from employees. That's also another second unfair. But anyway, we are here, software. We have privacy by design, not GDPR. Forwarding data, so you could be forwarding. When you forward data, personal data, you have to look, you have to think about who is responsible for the data. Usually you stay responsible for the data, not the other person. So you are responsible for the data. It doesn't matter who you forward it. When you forward the data, you stay responsible. In most cases, so you have to look at it. Then you have to make sure that your contractors, to whom you forward the data, won't abuse trusted information. So there is, you need a contract, you need to control them, and so on. Yeah, and how to control the contractors, that's also something you need to think about. Believe me, it's very funny. I tried to control DATEV. It was very funny. They didn't like it. But you have to think about how to control it. You have a control right. You have a control duty. So you have to think about when your software is for companies who are in this contractor situation. Then you may have to think about how will I code my software that controllers from their people can watch into it easily, and that I give the informations out very easy they need to control that my software is okay. That you have to think about. Then think storage. You don't want to store out of the European Union. Or Switzerland or Norway is okay too. When you do it, you have to fill lots of paper, and you have to look if the company is given in the something in the European list and so on. So believe me, you should make sure that your data stay in the European Union. We have a fun in the German tax law. It's given in the German tax law that German tax data have to be stored in Germany. So you might have to look into local rights if there's something given in there. As I said, we have it in the German tax law. That's very funny. I didn't know it until a data commissioner told me, and I said, what? Tax data, where is it? And I found it. Yeah, and you should make sure that your data won't leave the European Union. Who made an Nmap on Amazon server that are in Frankfurt? Did you ever make an Nmap? I did it. It was very funny. On all Amazon server that officially was placed in Frankfurt, my hops were to the Frankfurt Telekom Frankfurt port router. Then it went to USA, Amazon USA, then back to the Frankfurt Telekom router, and then to the Frankfurt Amazon data center. So I won't say that it's always at Amazon, but it was in all cases I made the Nmap, it was that way. So you should look. So you should make sure that it won't leave the European Union. And on transport, I'm pretty sure it will. I have a slide for it too. On the transport, you should make sure that your data were encrypted during the transport. It's another very important stuff.
Sorry.
Yeah? That's why you should encrypt them on the transport. But it's funny that they went to the US and then back to Europe. So.
No, that's, you probably did a DNS query. Did you an IP query or a DNS?
IP? Yeah, but I did IP and DNS, and it was both via US. It was very funny that they de-root them via US, yeah.
I'm using MailChimp for a newsletter, and they offer a GDPR agreement. And they are in US, so...
Yeah, you have to look if there is a list. There's another European privacy shield. And you have to look this in there. There is a privacy shield list with companies, and you have to look if the company is in there. It's a long list, but you can weigh A, B, to C, and so on. So there you have to look if it's listed, then it's okay. If it's not listed, then it's not okay. The company to use. And when you use Microsoft, so you really have to look at the finest end, if it's okay or not. Yeah?
Question every list. I have seen that list before. I look for the rules to come on the list. In my understanding, it's pretty easy to come on that list. You only register yourself behind the list.
Yeah, but if it would be so easy, then there were all Microsoft companies on it, and not just very small and not all. And so, and also there was another company, big company, something like in Ireland, yes, in there not. And so you really have to look differentially. So, but that's what's okay. So they accepted the privacy shield. So. You have to be law safe. That's another GDPR. It's a law, so it doesn't matter if the people will, if it hurt people or not. It's the law. As long as you are law safe, we can't say we all know that data get lost at transport in the U.S. or whatever else, that there are spies and the data not and whatever else. But we have to make sure that we are. Do all what's given by law. So it's like in kindergarten that parents aren't allowed to make photos and send them to Facebook. So the kindergartens should do a sign, no photos. So when a father or mother is doing a photo and plays it on the internet, it's, of course, it's hurting the child, but the kindergarten can say, okay, it's not our responsibility. We had made the sign, the father wasn't allowed to do it. So it's not the responsibility anymore for the kindergarten. Otherwise, when they don't do the signs, the kindergarten is responsibility, will have the responsibility and will get the penalty. And when there's a sign and the father's doing it, then they are safe. So that's, you have, yeah. You should, when you are still responsible, you have to do those measurements, of course. You have to control it. But when it happens anyway, so you have more rights and you have better to get this to in front of the court, to get the other in front of the court. That's also, yeah? I would try not to send data out of the European Union. That's, I always recommend look that you stay in the European Union. So as long as you don't need because you have US business, also that's a different. But then usually the person, the data subject knows it too. When you have something to deliver from the US or so, then you can inform. But usually, I would recommend don't use server in the US, use server in Europe and make sure that it stays in Europe.
But doesn't mean, for example, if you're an American
company, yeah,
that is developing their own software,
yeah,
and they have customers from Europe,
yeah,
and they have to put the customer data, not, they shouldn't store it in the US, they should store it in Europe.
Yes.
To create software
that no. The European, when there's a US company, a global company, they have to have a data commissioner, they have to a person in the European Union who looks into the GDPR stuff. What's given there, that's European Union, the companies will get this from this. But they have to have a person in the EU who is looking into it, hired person. So
it can't be
an American person. No, it had to be a European.
Living in America, it can't be a person living in America.
No, in any case, not because the person have to be close to the data subject.
And the data of the European customers, is it to store in Europe?
I don't know. That depends what they discuss with the European Union. Yes, usually it is that way, but it's what the Commission says. So they have to make rules. So global companies are international and they are third party, and so that's something the Commissioner, the European Commissioner, have to make rules for them. It could be very different. So they have to ask the European Commissioner, and they have to have a person in Europe who is dealing with it.
So even if it's like a 10-person company?
It doesn't matter. It's an international company. So, but of course, when you have this international companies, of course, you have to look. It's the same what Microsoft, Facebook, Google is doing lots of in Germany, in Switzerland, not in the US. Facebook, I think Facebook in Ireland or so. So look where they have their data center. Even big US companies often don't have those data centers in the US. They often have it in Great Britain, they often have it in Switzerland, they often have it in Germany. That's a coast. Often it has to do with costs. So they often store data in the European Union anyway, or something somewhere in Europe or in China or whatever else, not in the US. But that's something you have to deal with the European Commission.
From what you're saying, I cannot make business with a local US company because they cannot make...
You can make business, you are not allowed to transfer personal data from European persons.
No, I mean if the company is a US local only, they cannot offer something which I from Europe can use, like a shop. I cannot buy in a US shop.
You can buy in the US shop, but the company makes sure that it considers European law.
Which in fact would mean they're not allowed to deliver to Germany if they don't.
No, when they offer in Germany, they have to make sure that they are allowed to offer in Germany.
How do they control that?
I don't know. I would make the talk because I still have a lot of slides. Technical and organizational measurement. You have to describe it. What are you doing? How to keep the data safe? Did you ensure that authorized persons have committed themselves to the confidentiality? That's very, very, very important, this confidential agreement. Did you ensure authorized person regularly awareness raising and privacy data protection? So that's also, you need to train your employees. Are technical solutions documented? You need to document each stuff, every stuff, and also the organizational stuff you need to document. Then we have pseudonymization. And it's what does it mean? Pseudonymization means you have the server with the original data, stuff team, and you have people who are able to read this data and work with this data, stuff team, admin team, data center. IP addresses usually are personal data that's given by the court, and so the data center always also have this. So you have the data sets here, the original data. Then you have a key for each data set. Oh, it's my blue box is okay. So, but this key server have to have another staff team, another admin team, and another data center. And then you have this pseudonymized data, and there should be a third team. So that no administrator is able to have the key and to... So here on this side, that the administrator here isn't able to have the key and get out the original data. And... So that's why, and also the staff should not be able to get the key and get the original data. Only these people can get the key and get the original data. And these people are just for the keys. That's how the best way is.
So you have to make sure that this isn't allowed. These people are not able to decrypt the data. That's how it should work. Pseudonymize. Encryption, transport, storage, global, local. Yeah. I think you all know what's transcription. Transparency. You should provide all information where personal data are collected. That's given in Article 13 and 14. GDPR, that's a list you just need to fill. It's a form you just need to fill. Concise, transparent, intelligible, easily accessibility form. Yeah, that's something you have to use. That's for the Germans, it's very, very important. You have to make it easy to read. I saw from a lawyer group an example. They had a sentence that long. Six layers. And I said, okay. I am academically, but I have to think about what the sentence means. And you say it's easy to read. And I said, okay, what do you expect from lawyers? So easy to read is very important. Today, the German commission is on the way to look into websites and if these data information are easy to read. And you will get penalty if they are not easy to read. And that's a very funny, not really funny translation error in the German GDPR. In the English GDPR, they are talking from a remote access. The data subject should get a remote access. In this recital. Also, that's also translated with Fremdzugang in German. That's okay. But there's also an article about the access right for the data subject. In German, it's translated as Auskunft. May I say, no, it's not the same. So it could be funny. So you have, if it's possible, give your data subject access and then it could look into that data by their own. And here are the rights from the data subject. As I said, it has the right to access, right of rectification, right of erasure, and right of to be forgotten. Somebody told it data were in Germany already caught data already gone, but the US still have had it. I hear it today. Right of restriction and processing, that's usually when you delete them, that's for when you need it in front of court. Right of notification, so inform the data subject if you change something. Right of portability, that's a very, very funny stuff. I don't know what the European Union means. You can't do anything else as give out. That means the idea is that you can use the data from one software into another software. So that people will get it. I'm waiting for some HR, and some employees asking their old HR, give me all my data, right of portability, that my new employer will get, will fill it. So usually in my technical understanding today, it's made in, so either you give an XML or CSV out, CSV out. But be careful, if you hand out this XML, make sure your database structure usually is under company secret. So don't give off your database structure because it's confidential. I like it. I always say when I get this question, I always say give a CSV. And then you have lots of, okay, you might have the name and you have lots of numbers. And nobody can use it anymore, but data portability. So, and you have to make sure that you won't hurt other rights here, especially in the data portability. When you have Facebook, for example, you want this data and you want all your friends and port for another software. Yeah, of course, all your friends have rights too, so you won't get it. So,
It was something the Hamburg Commission had this idea with Facebook and all the friends, and we looked at him and said, no, that's against data, GDPR. So, stuff rights. That's very funny. That's very, very important. Stuff have rights. Don't abuse stuff rights. GDPR is also for stuff. Security and privacy protection are often not compatible here. GDPR should win. This was what you asked already. Consents. Yeah, I told it. Was it freely given? So I said employees never can give us consent because it's never freely. What happened when it's not given? So when you have when you will collect data for which you need a consent, then you should think about what happens when it's not given. So if it's not given, the data subject should not get any negative follows for it. So either you give it or not. So, okay, when you say, you give me your birthday data, your birthday, then you will get a birthday card. Of course, when you know, won't give me your birthday date, I can't send you a birthday card. Pretty clear. But when you say, for this free software, cost-free software, give me all your data, will you give me all your data, and you give them, then I should get the software too when I won't give you all my data. Because it's cost-free, you don't need my data. So it should be all possible that I can download the software. And when I give you your data, okay, that's different, but or when you get this newsletter, you will get the software. Now, when I won't give you the consent, send me a newsletter, I have the right to get the software too. So no negative follows. Is there a clear process on consent withdrawal? So when you have a consent, you should... the data subject is withdrawing it. You should immediately react and stop whatever it was. So don't send a newsletter anymore. Don't use the photo on the internet anymore, whatever else. So immediately. Coupling bans, I just said, it's forbidden. You will get discount if you leave your data for marketing reasons. That's forbidden. Your kid will get better medical supplies if you leave your data for marketing reasons. Also forbidden. You will get a present when you agree in getting a new or a newsletter. It's stuff you will see a lot, but it's all forbidden. You only will get our service if you agree to give us your data for marketing reasons. Sweepstakes. For getting personal data for marketing reasons. So it's all forbidden. So.
There are almost all online shops in Germany, for example, today, they offer like 10% discount if you sign up.
It's forbidden. The data commissioners are on that topic already. So you can announce it to the data commissions and it's forbidden, cobbling bans. Pardon?
So, like when they're saying, you're having this thing for marketing reasons just to make better things and everything. So, if you opt out of that,
opt out is forbidden anyway. It always has to be opt in. You're not allowed to make an opt-out because it's free will and you have to make sure that it opt in. So it has to mark so that the will is given. Otherwise, it's also forbidden.
Where is this defined?
Huh?
Where is this defined?
That's in the GDPR. It's given in the GDPR. It's in German, it's Kopplungsverbot. No, it's given in the GDPR. It's in the paragraph GDPR that's on the consent given. It's, the consent has not be to free will and in this paragraph where the consent is described.
Yeah, but
Yeah, but I understand free will, but I think that free will does not.
No, no. There is a an article in the GDPR that have consent and all what's with it, and that's one of the sub paragraphs is this coupling ban. It's given in, I don't know the article, I think it's article 23, 24 or something like this. So it's given in the GDPR that you aren't allowed to seven, thank you. Seven, that way? Yeah. So staff assess, this is something about staff rights. I tried to create a log file. You know, Frank is entering the room, Anna is entering the room, Frank is logged in, Frank is changed. So you have this staff control here. You can look at it. You shouldn't do it that way. I no, security people say, oh, that's good. Yeah, do it that way. You should do it that way. HR is entering through service EMEA West. So you have groups of people, you have roles, you don't have names. And on customers, okay, that's a little bit tricky. Because you sometimes need to know if the customer changed the data by its own, by his own, or if, I don't know, a supporter changed it. So you can say customer changing it, and of course you can say here customer from account stuff, so that you don't have the names of the employees here. Because when you have the names of the employees here, it's very funny. It's think about what do you do, need you to do, when Frank is quit, has quit, you have to delete this from this log file because there's his name in it. And he's gone, so you have to delete it. Yeah. No, you should not do it that way. You should be make sure that staff right will be given. It's enough for entering the room, and I say there's something, there's a WAP in the room. And it's enough when you say, who has access to the room? And you have three or five people assessing the room. And the WAP just can be one of these five people, when you, for example. So it's enough to have these groups and not a single person, because staffs have employees have rights. Yeah, access control. We are over time. Access control is... yeah, we have an access control. Then we have customer access, I already said. B2B or B2C. This is, you have to look, we are always in B2C in the data privacy, not B2B. B2B is, doesn't matter. Will the delivery address be removed in closing and so on? So, customer access law, documentation, you need to document every each stuff. And I have a summary, and I'm 5 minutes over time already, but we are the last talk. So. First time on first come that I have talk. I'm over time. Usually I have, my talks are too short. Anyway, you can ask me some questions as soon as I, the cameraman. So, we can, is it still recording? Okay, then we need to do it in English. okay.
I got a question. I don't know how it's mean in the European context, but in the DSGVO, Article 6, berechtigtes Interesse, there are some backdoors, I think.
No, that's also already in front of the European Court. We have this Vertrag, and berechtigtes Interesse. Vertrag says no marketing, and the European Court says no marketing. And berechtigtes Interesse in Germany, and also usually it's the data subject has to be the most interest. So the interest has to be on the data subject. So when I want to deliver, when you want that I deliver a parcel to you, then it's in your interest that you give me your address. When you want, or when you want that I will transfer your money or get your money from your bank account, then it's in your interest that you get me a safer mandate. So you have to make sure you always have, also you have to describe the interest for the data subject. So you can't say, oh, I will do marketing, personal marketing, because of berechtigtes Interesse or because of this interests. Because you have to think, okay, will the data subject really get my prospects, my flyers? And usually it's not, so that's not allowed. So, but it will be clear, it's in the moment, it's in front of the European court. So, but it's, as far as I understand, the German data commissioner is part of the complainers in front of court. Das ist das berechtigte Interesse, ja. Achso, die Slides, die habe ich jetzt gerade abgekoppelt. Ja, ja.
A question here. You said that personally identifiable information may not leave the EU. How does that play with Brexit?
Brexit is, as when the Brexit will come, the Great Britain is a third-party country. It depends. As I said, there were agreements with Switzerland, with Norway, and some others. And if Great Britain makes an agreement with EU, then it's fine. If not, then not. So EU is Great Britain is for Brexit is a moment. At the moment is unclear. So yeah. So I can imagine that they will have this agreement, but when you look into this discussions, no deal deal stuff, it could be that they won't get out with this deal, and then you then. But it will hurt UK. I know that lots of companies who have server in the UK already placed them in other European countries already now. So especially phone companies that they thus already moved their servers. So, but yeah, Brexit UK at the moment it's EU. So,
So I really did not get understand the coupling ban thing. You said that the one can cannot deny services if we don't provide them marketing data.
Yeah.
Right? Was it that?
No. When you when a company wants that you give your personal data. For marketing, and then you will only get a discount when you leave your personal data. So you don't need your personal data to leave your personal data because whatever it's a software you can download for free or so. You don't need to leave your personal data because you just can download it. So there's no reason why you need to leave your personal data. And the company says, okay, when you get us your personal data so that we can send you a newsletter or marketing stuff, you will get 10 euro from us.
Yeah.
Or if you buy something, a discount. That's not allowed.
But often, website blogs, like if I don't agree with their terms of condition or something, and if I don't agree with them, that they collect my IP address and things like that. They just don't...
IP address, there's a law.
Okay.
IP address needs to be stored 7 days. There's a law for it. But almost 95% of this cookie and stuff is illegal at the moment. Portugal has already earned 400,000 euro for this illegal data information and cookie stuff. Germany, in some countries in Germany, the commissioners are on that topic, and looking at especially, I think Baden-Württemberg is on that topic at the moment, that the companies have, okay, cookie warnings or not cookie warnings, that they get legal. So they are getting penalties out now in Germany too.
You can provide they say like, okay, if you leave your data with us, you have like this discount and everything. But I think that's only at the end or at the beginning, but you can still like opt out for some things.
Yeah, that's very often you can, Oracle, for example, MySQL, like you can download it without leaving your data, but it's a very small button in a corner. And
maybe it's illegal the way they're phrasing. Maybe they cannot alleviate the people. Maybe they should just say like, do you mind like leaving your data with us? But you can still say no. But
yeah. If you still can say no, then it's okay.
What she wants to say is, it is legal to offer a discount for something that you only get if you leave your data.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you will not be able to get a discount.
But is that already decided? Because
Yes.
No, it's not. No. Yes. The definition is that you cannot deny the service, but the service is not.
If you would get the discount,
that's
not leaving your data.
Then the question becomes whether that discount is a service. The service is selling you things. The service is not necessarily providing you a discount. So you might not deny the actual service.
If the data is not needed for the service, then you only get the discount.
But the discount is not a service.
No, but it's given in the GDPR on more than one article. It's also given in the rectangles.
It's not in the GDPR. The GDPR says that you might not deny providing the service. The service is selling you goods, and you pay a price for that. But the discount is selling you the same goods for lesser price.
Yeah, that's a service.
But then I think that the European Court needs to decide whether...
It's already decided that it's forbidden.
That looks strange to me because it's only in effect for 1 year. So this new regulation is only since May last year. So I think there are no decisions yet.
Oh, we have it in Germany since 2009.
Germany,
yeah.
Yeah, but that doesn't count.
But it's one. But there are also in this pre. That's also given this discount. So it's in this Article 7, and it's given other stuff in the GDPR too. Yeah, but the consent have to be, you are not allowed to make any negative stuff for them, and so that's what I meant. What it meant
the text of regulation doesn't say that. It says that you cannot deny the service, but the question becomes whether this discount is part.
Yeah, but when then it's not a free given will anymore. When you get a discount, you have not a free will anymore. Yeah, because you are forced to give your data to get the discount. That's not the free will anymore. No. So it's very tricky, but they will discuss it that way. So the free will is very, very, very...
What is it saying, that the discount is in
product?
Yeah, in Article 7.
No, it's not stated.
There is that it has to be a free will.
Ladies and gentlemen, before we... stay here all night.
I would like to make
a proposal. You should go outside and join the social event, and there you can discuss.
Yeah.